Ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, welcome to Milano-Bicocca. We are homaging you with four traditional songs which touch upon the themes of this Congress: its work, gender, prison, love, and hope. And this is the cultural association Le Voci di Mezzo, who keep on traditions and bring them on and transmit them.
Oh, Oh. Prussia che il mondo se cambia de fondo non sia più bestia. Se spera che i sassi diventan paneti, perché i poeti se possa saziar. Se spera che l'acqua diventa champagne, perché noi se lagna chi vuol giubilar. Se spera che il caldo principia in genaro e senza tabaro poter camminar. Se spera che adesso non asa più tose, perché le morose se possa sposar. Se spera che il nostro governo non voglia in eterno le tasse lassar. Se spera e sperando ne capita l'ora di andare in buon'ora col nostro sperar. Se spera e sperando ne capita l'ora di andare in mal'ora col nostro sperar.
So this is the official opening of the EASA, and I give, now is going to speak the president of EASA, Thomas Hilland Eriksson.
Thank you, Sylvia. So, dear EASA members, honored guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure for me to welcome you all to the opening of this, the 14th biennial conference of the EASA in Milano-Bicocca. Social anthropology is perhaps in a paradoxical and unusual situation these days, a situation which may prompt perhaps future historians of the discipline to invoke Dickens and quote him to the effect of, it was the best of times, it was the worst of times, because on the one hand, this discipline is clearly thriving. The interest in our conferences is growing. There is an increased publication activity. There's an increased intensity in the professional discourse. And at the same time, we have a situation in many European countries and perhaps even across the continent which reminds us of the fact that being an anthropologist in Europe or of Europe these days perhaps carries with it a special responsibility which was not as palpable even at the last EASA conference in Tallinn. We have countries in Europe where there is harassment and persecution of academics and intellectuals like anthropologists, such as in Turkey. But even in the more benign and peaceful parts of Europe, there is a real sense in which anthropological knowledge, or the kind of knowledge that anthropologists typically produce, is not welcomed in the way that it may have been only a decade or two ago. There is an intellectual climate in which we now have to maneuver, where we cannot take it for granted that the outside world is initially generous to our perspectives, which is also a reminder of the fact that what we do is probably more important than it ever was. Sometimes one may think that if an economist and an anthropologist are in the same room and both of them are asked to give a talk, the audience will respond to the economist by concluding that what he has to say is really very important. And then comes the anthropologist, and they may conclude that, yeah, what the anthropologist has to say is really fascinating. And one of the tasks at hand for us in EASA is to show the world that what is fascinating can also be important. And when we decided on the topic, on the overarching theme for this conference, anthropological legacies and human futures, this may have been some of the things that we had in mind. The ability to look to the past in order to think ahead, to draw on 100 plus years of anthropological research and anthropological knowledge in order to deepen our understanding and to sharpen our perspectives and to make our engagement with the outside world even more acute than it was before. In what ways can we use the knowledge that has been accumulated and criticized and deconstructed and refined over the last 100 plus years to come to terms with the challenges and the issues that are facing us today? These are some of the things that I personally hope will come out of this conference, and I'm confident that it will, because there are so many great people here and great panels and other activities. So on that note, I wish you some very productive and stimulating days here in Milan. Not too hot, just the right temperature for someone from Scandinavia. Okay? And the air conditioning is still working. So on that note, thanks for being here and thank you for your attention.
And now I invite Professor Gianfranco Pacchioni, who is Vice Rector of the University.
So, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure for me to be here tonight and to give you a very warm welcome in name of our Rector, Professor Cristina Mestra. She could not be here today. Of course, warm in every sense, but if you organize a meeting in Milano in July, this is what you should expect, that's absolutely normal. So it's also I'm very pleased to see the lecture room, our Aula Magna, so full. I think I don't think I've remembered to have seen so many people, because it's almost 1,000 people which can be accumulated here, so it's a great success. Of course, our university is a young university. We have been created about 20 years ago, but it's a very lively university, and it has been created in an area which was also interesting from an anthropological point of view, because this was the wall area where we are now. It's about 1 million square meters, where Pirelli is an important company, had their factories producing tires and cables. And so where we are now is a factory which has been rebuilt and renovated. And we are in a place where workers were working until, I would say, 1970, 1980s. Now we are a university of about 32,000 students, and we have 900 faculty members. We have activities and in almost every field. We have a medical school and so on, natural sciences, economy, and of course, we have also anthropology, which is one of our strengths, I have to say. And this was created thanks to the initiative of Professor Ugo Fabietti. He's not here with us today, unfortunately, but we are, he's with us in at least in spirit. And he has been very successful in creating a very strong school. And in fact, we have a master in anthropology, we have a PhD in anthropology, and we have very many active scientists working in anthropology. Some of them have been extremely successful also in getting recognition, international recognition. So I think it's the right place to have this kind of meeting. And I hope you will enjoy your stay in Milano. You will sustain the temperature outside. Inside is a little bit better. So you will, it's a strong motivation to attend the conferences. And for the rest, I can only hope to wish you a great stay and a great success with your conference. Thank you very much.
I invite to speak Professor Maria Grazia Riva, who is head of the Department of Human Science for Education, Riccardo Massa.
Good evening to all of you. Just a few words. I am very glad to welcome you on behalf of the colleagues and staff of the Department of Human Sciences for Education, Riccardo Massa. We are very proud that the European Association of Social Anthropologists chose our institutions as its venue. We see this conference as a big opportunity to strengthen the anthropological and interdisciplinary tradition of our department. We believe in the role that human and social sciences can play in the positive transformation of society, especially in this complicated historical moment, as remember before. Do think about what is going on in Turkish universities just now. The work of anthropologists paves the way to new educational models that cross cultures, religions, and social classes. I wish to thank Professor Fabietti and then Professor Alice Bellagamba, Silvia Vignato, Roberto Malighetti, and all the other members of the local committee for their efforts in the organization of such an important event. Moreover, without the students who volunteered, we would not be here. So, many, many thanks to them. And and finally, I wish you a very fruitful conference. Thank you.
Now I invite to speak Professor Giampaolo Nuvolati, head of the Department of Sociology.
Sociology.
It's an honor for me, as the director of the Department of Sociology and Social Research, to welcome you and to host this conference. The conference has been organized together with the Department of the Human Science of Education. Let's say something about sociology and anthropology. As we all know, these are two different disciplines. However, they share a lot of theoretical and methodological approach in analyzing our society, especially when we deal with actors and situations of the everyday life, when we deal with the so-called interstitial space of our life, anthropology and sociology can contribute together to improve the analysis of the ongoing transformation, looking at the individual behavior as well as at the structural, cultural, and institutional frames. As I am also an urban sociologist, let me also add that cities represent nowadays a crucial context to look at in order to explore new anthropological transformation. And therefore, I am very glad that urban issues are at the core of this important conference. I would like to thank all the organizers of this event, Silvia Vignato, Alice Bellagamba, and Simone Ghezzi. But I would also thank you for being here. I hope you have time to visit this wonderful city that is Milan. Thanks a lot.
I now invite to speak Professor Roberto Malighetti, who is of our Department of Anthropology.
Thank you. Dear EASA members, conference delegates, and guests, I'm very pleased and honored to join my colleagues in welcoming you on behalf of the local committee and of the Dean of Anthropology in Italy and in Bicocca, the already mentioned Professor Ugo Fabietti, who is not present because of some health problems that we all hope will be solved very, very quickly. It is the second time that Italy hosts a major EASA event. The first was the inaugural General Assembly held in Castel Gandolfo in 1989, that marked the very foundation of the association. With more than 1,700 delegates, the 14th EASA conference is the largest so far. This can not only be considered a sign of the success of the association, it can also be regarded as the result of the conspicuous development of anthropology in Italy that only recently has come to a whirling slowdown. The 1999 reform of Italian university system granted anthropology a place that had been denied by the previous academic organization. although the institution of the first chair of anthropology in Italy dates back to 1869, it was not possible to graduate in anthropology until the end of the millennium. There were only single courses with curricula in other social sciences or human sciences. The institutional changes brought by the Bologna process opened up the opportunity for a disciplinary expansion and for the creation of innovative programs capable to respond to the social demand for anthropological knowledge. A considerable number of universities launched first and second level courses specifically devoted to cultural and social anthropology. New PhD programs were introduced to integrate the existing ones created in the 80s. Postgraduate specialization courses and schools were conceived to complete the educational offer and to dialogue with the interlocutors outside the university and with the so-called third sector. Over the same period, the associations of anthropologists such as ISEA and ANUAC, or the Association of Medical Anthropology, intensified their activities, while new ones were created, such as the Museum Anthropology Society and the Society for Applied Anthropology. The number of journals, publications, and translations increased considerably. If in 1977 there were 21 professors of anthropology teaching single courses in 16 public universities, today there are 153 professors. In 2008 were 209, concentrated in BA and master programs in social and cultural anthropology. This significant development is facing today a moment of worrying recession, due mainly to the neoliberal policies aimed to reduce the relevance of public education. The danger of downsizing of the discipline is as real as contradictory when compared to the still growing demand of anthropology and the need for a critical anthropological thought solidly based on ethnographic research. In this problematic scenario, the anthropology at Bicocca has played the role of one of the main resistance points. Its rapid and intense growth has been fostered and protected by the need to develop this new university and by the efficient commitments of the founding fathers. Today, it hosts the largest Italian group of anthropologists, 13 professors, 5 postdocs, 30 PhD students, and a master program in cultural and social anthropology, which since 2002 has attracted about 100 students from all over Italy every year. It also offers the only PhD program in social and cultural anthropology in the country. All other PhD programs in anthropology have been closed, hit by the cuts to education. Anthropology at Bicocca has offered 3 postgraduate courses in applied and medical anthropology, in anthropology of migrations, and in cultural heritage. We have founded a research center and 3 journals. Of these, only one, Anthropologia, a peer-reviewed and open access journal, has survived the lack of financial resources. The hosting in Bicocca of the EASA Congress ratifies these notable achievements and questions a crisis that is not just national and does not affect only anthropology. It invests the social roles of intellectuals in a society dangerously nourished by obscure pulses and incapable to think. I'm sure the Congress will succeed to analyze and propose valid contributions to understand the complexities and the dramatic problems of the contemporary world and to operate among them. Ringraziandovi quindi tutti per il vostro impegno e per la vostra partecipazione, auguro a tutti buon lavoro. Thank you.